So I'm so excited to have Haveed Rahani and Rob Tobb from Madeka Copper joining us today. They'll be talking with us about their Tuju Bukit copper gold porphyry and gold silver high sulfidation deposits. So with recent updates on their most recent drilling in line with or exceeding expectations, it is going to be wonderful hearing from them today. So I hope you all enjoy it. Please use the chat. You'll have the chance to jump off mute and we'll open up the floor for discussions at the end. And yes, thank you so much for joining us, Rob and Haveed. It's wonderful having you.
Hi, thanks for having us on the show. Very excited to be here as well. Just checking in, you can hear me okay? Yes, good, perfect. So we're going to talk about what's been happening with Tuju Bukit. And around about 2017, the drilling kicked off again after a hiatus, and we've done more than 70 kilometres of drilling over the last few years. And today we're going to share with you what we have been finding. So the brains behind what we've been doing is Mr. Haveed sitting next to me. So I'm going to let him do most of the talking. Take it away, Bart.
Thank you, Paro. Good day, everyone. Thank you, Jessica, for inviting us. It's an honor to me to be here. My name is Muhammad Haveed Rahadi. I'm senior porphyry study geologist from PT Merdeka Copper and Gold. Maybe we can start it. PT Merdeka Copper and Gold is a holding company from several mining projects in Indonesia. And today's Merdeka owns three major projects. The first one is Tuju Bukit in Banyuwangi, and then Pani in Gorontalo, and also Wetar in Maluku Island. The Tuju Bukit is located at Sumber Agung Village, Pesanggaran Banyuwangi, East Java, Indonesia. Under PT Bumi Sukses Indo, Merdeka Subsidiary, it owns two mining permit, exploration and operation mining permit. The Tuju Bukit project is located in certain oligomiocene volcanic arc. We can easily divide this volcanic arc from its surrounding by the intense faulting and erosional features within this volcanic arc. In the northern part, we have an active volcanoes. One of them is Ijen, related to Tuju Bukit. This is showing us a glimpse of what really happened in the Tuju Bukit in the past, especially related to advanced argillic and high sulfidation mineralization. And about the Tuju Bukit, about the Ijen, currently the Banyuwangi government has officially proposed the Ijen Geopark as the part of UNESCO Global Geopark, or as known as the World Geopark Network. And for your information, Ijen volcano has the most acidic crater and maybe the only natural blue flames in the world. The blue flames are basically caused by burning liquid sulfur, and then when it's still molten, the color is as red as blood and getting yellow when it's crystallized. This sulfur mineralization has been mined since 1911 by the locals, actually.
Just one thing about that, the blue fire there is absolutely incredible. I did take my family to go into the crater of that volcano about 2 years ago, and you've got to go there in the middle of the night to see it because it's not a really super bright blue flame, but it is totally dangerous, and I would never do that again, and I really wish I didn't take my family down there. You've got to walk down this narrow goat track into the crater of the volcano, and if you slip over, you're going to take out a few other old people who are already on their way down that little narrow goat track, or you'll be taken out by someone else falling behind you. And there's no way to get out easily. You've got to be carried out by the sulfur miners, which would be harrowing in itself. Anyway, don't go there.
Yeah. In the future, the government also built the infrastructure to get us easily to go the under.
Make it a bit safer to get in there. That's a dangerous track.
And then we start from the exploration history in Tuju Bukit. Exploration activity has been started since 1991 to 1999 by Hakman, GVM, and Paserdum. They did channel sampling along the Pulau Merah and returning 47 meters at 1.7 ppm gold and 1.3% copper with initial 5 diamond drill hole, maximum 500 meters at that time, resulting limited success. So they're leaving the project. Talking about Pulau Merah, this is the Pulau Merah. beautiful beach with a breathtaking sunset actually, and the Discovery Outrop is only somewhere around here. And as we can see in here, we have intense malachite staining right in the landmark of the Banyuwangi, the Pulau Merah, and also a lot of boulders of overprinted quartz top look. So basically, this is very easy to discover at that time.
Yeah, this is a complete walk up. It's a no-brainer. The Pulau Merah means red island, and the reason it's red is it's an oxidizing part of an ore body. So all those ferrous bits are all turning red and rusty and an oxidizing hematite kind of stuff. But on that side that Habib was pointing out, there's a big section of beautiful green malachite. It's very hard to miss. You can walk across there at low tide, and if you ever come to Pulau Merah, it's definitely worth checking the tide times, going for a walk over there and checking out some amazing outcrops. It's a national park, so it will never be mined. But this is a stone's throw away from where we're actually doing the mining, and it's all part of the same big system.
Maybe one of the best porphyry outcrop in the world. Easily can be accessed.
Easy.
Continue from the exploration history. In 2006 to 2008, approximately 3 million ounces gold equivalent potential for Oxet project were delineated by EMN and Interpret with highly prospective consideration for bigger deposit underneath the Oxet project. In 2008 to 2012, using soil geochemistry and RTP magnetic data set, the first porphyry discovery hole, GTD0829, intersects 268 meters at 0.47 ppm gold and 0.3% copper, including 100 meters at 1 ppm gold and 0.5% copper. Maybe you will explain about it.
The people may be familiar with Intrepid's dramas that they had with this. So Intrepid ended up losing the property to the Indonesian government because they didn't have clear tenure. As we all know, one of the things that you need to have when you're doing some serious exploration and spending money, like I think these guys drilled around about 70 kilometres or 65 kilometres worth of drilling, and then they didn't have the correct tenure situation in place and they ended up losing the property. And that's where Merdeka stepped in.
And in 2012 until now, under PT Bumi Sukses Indo, Merdeka took over the property and start the infrastructure development in 2015 to 2016. The first gold and silver extraction from heap leach process commenced in 2017, and the underground decline development commenced in 2018 to support the RESTEF drilling and underground pre-feasibility study program. On the regional scale, the Tujuh Bukit is located on eastern Sunda Banda Ak. The proven metallogenic belt for porphyry copper and gold deposit shared with the Batu Hijau and Elang ex-Numon property, and also the recent discovery from Sori Onto deposit from Vale. There are several northwest southeast transfer fault that possibly cause these mineral districts in the Sunda Banda Ak. On the district scale, under RTP magnetic data set, there are several magnetic bullseyes along this northwest structural corridor. But the Tujuh Bukit is characterized by medium magnetic anomaly due to the advanced argillic overpaint that destroyed the initial magnetic and potassic alterations. In the northwestern part, similar characteristic to Tujuh Bukit, the Salakan prospect also showing a broad zone of moderate magnetic anomaly. And also above it, we also have advanced argillic alterations. As well as with the geochemical signatures, Salakan also show a broad zone of porphyry suit mineralization, especially copper, gold, and moly. And some drill holes were drilled in this prospect. However, the main mineralization is still waiting to be discovered. With a total 14 kilometers multiplied 3 kilometers square, the Tujuh Bukit should be considered as a world-class mineral district.
One thing that's cool about this area is that in the immediate Tujuh Bukit area, is not only do we have the big porphyry there with the awesome high sulfidation thing sitting on the top, but over to the east there is Gunung Manis, which is a low sulfidation epithermal. That's the trifecta. Very cool.
And for project resources in Tujuh Bukit, we can divide our project resources into surface and underground project resources. In 2020, we have updated our surface resources containing 1.9 million ounces of gold and 77 million ounces of silver. And in also mid-2020, we have finished our decline development to support the RESDEF drilling program. And this underground RESDEF drilling program is targeting around 250 to 300 million ton at 0.7 to 0.9% copper and PPM gold within the global gold query at 1.9 billion ton at 0.45% copper and PPM gold. The geological history in Tujuh Bukit began with the volcano sedimentary host rock deposition consisting of the sandstone and siltstone and some intercalated volcanic andesite, and some of in the distal area we have the intercalated limestones. And the first stratomagmatic breccia generated in the beginning of the Tujuh Bukit magmatism. Right after that, the magma comes up and developing the volcano dacite dome in the top of the system. And the underneath parental magma start crystallization and leaving the magma residue in the middle of the system.
It might look strange, that purple rock, which is the precursor diorite, how it kind of looks like a big Batman shape. When I first looked at this interpretation, I was a little bit confused and I asked Fahad, what's going on with it? How come you've got it coming up there like the sides over there? And he goes, dude, you can see it down on the beach. That's exactly how it really is. So, yes, the Batman shape is real.
With the structural reactivation, the magma residue, which is rich in metal and high volatile, comes up and developing the initial porphyry copper and gold mineralization in Tujuh Bukit.
So it's important to note that that pink rock is the tonalite intrusives, and that was the first bit of the mineralization, or the main bit that emplaced the gold and the copper and the porphyry style stuff. And you can see the little dotted outline there. They're the rocks that were there at the time that are where all the metal is.
And then the last dry magma residue cuts everything and providing the hyperbasalt dacite intrusions as the root zone of the second stratomagmatic breccia before the dome emplacement in the top of the system. These three lithologies are the post-porphyry lithologies, and these post-porphyry lithologies pushing our initial porphyry mineralization slightly to the outer of the porphyry lithology. And also this post-porphyry also associated with advanced argillic overprint that structurally controlled. This advanced argillic overprint transform some of the initial porphyry mineralization to higher sulfidation state mineralization.
So that's like changing some of the bornite and the chalcopyrite into covellite and
energite
and chalcocite.
And this is the schematic illustration for remobilization process. So basically in the plan view, we have the initial porphyry lithology is complete with the quartz stockwork zones right in the middle of the miniature pulpat basin. And the post-porphyry lithologies intruded right in the middle of the system associated with advanced argillic overprint. This post-porphyry lithology is pushing the mineralization slightly to the outer of the initial stockwork zones. And also the advanced argillic overprint transform the chalcopyrite bornite mineral assemblage to energite, chalcocite, and cobalt mineralization. This is the schematic timeline diagram showing the relationship between lithology, alteration, and mineralization in Tujuh Bukit. Basically, we have the pre-porphyry rocks, and then the porphyry rocks associated with potassic and porphyry mineralization, before being cut by the post-porphyry lithology that strongly associated with advanced argillic alteration and late gold and silver high sulfidation mineralization. Our modeling in Tujuh Bukit are supported by 78 uranium lead dating samples, and it successfully separating the volcano sedimentary host rock and the first stratomagmatic breccia from the coherent rock. In volcanic dacite, precursor diorite, old and young tonalite, and also post-porphyry lithologies showing a young trend. However, there's some age overlapping between those lithology due to the co-magmatic characteristic between those lithologies. And it's common because the age between those intrusions are slightly different. And the spread of the dating possibly around 1 million annum. So it's common, I guess. We're moving on to the Tujuh Bukit high sulfidation gold and silver. Basically, in Tujuh Bukit, we have classic high sulfidation with structurally controlled in the deeper part and lithological cut in the near surface. The predominant ore body in Tujuh Bukit commonly oxidized, and there appears as a fine grain electrum and gold and silver terrorite that's strongly associated with iron oxide. This is a schematic section from the oxide project. Basically, the mineralization are strongly associated with the silica intensity. So when we have the argyric rock in here, it doesn't show any mineralization. And also in this weak clay alteration, it's showing maybe insignificant mineralization. While in the foggy silica, massive dense silica, and also hydrothermal breccia, especially with iron oxide cement, showing or host the best mineralization.
One thing that's really cool about the high sulfidations, as everybody knows who's been playing with them, when they're in that oxidized style, it's really easy to get the gold out with a heap leach. So it's quite cheap and simple and very environmentally friendly if you manage it correctly. So the production costs for the surface operations has been astoundingly good for us.
And this is aerial photography from Tujuh Bukit. Basically, we are using conventional open pit mining and hauling method and also heap leach processing in metallurgy. Yeah, I'm forgetting this one. This one is the Pulau Merah, the discovery outcrop from our porphyry. And for ore processing facilities, basically our ore will be crushed into maximum 75 millimeter, and the ore will be transported and stuck into the heap leach pad, and then irrigated by the cyanide solution, and the cyanide will be taking the gold and silver and then accumulated in the dump. And then the pregnant solution will be pumped into the ADR, and ADR will be separating the cyanide from the gold and silver, and the pure cyanide will be coming back to the heap leach pad, and the cycles keep moving on. We're moving on to the main part. This is the Tujuh Bukit copper gold porphyry. In the plan view, we can see that the Tujuh Bukit porphyry are localized right in the middle of the divergent strike slip structural corridor. In the middle part, we have the post-porphyry lithologies that cuts the porphyries and providing a central barren zone. And actually, our ore body shape is just like a donut. So with that ore body understanding, we changed our drilling plan from north-east-southwest grid drilling program to radial drilling program from the central barren core. This improvement approximately saved the drilling metrage up to 30%, especially the barren core and the PQ core. And the drilling direction in this section, it's almost perpendicular to the mineralization zone. So it's gonna helping us in the modeling program.
Okay. Okay.
This is the rock variability from Tujuh Bukit. Basically, we have the volcano sedimentary host rock. We have sandstone, siltstone, and also intermediate sandstone and siltstone. And then the volcanic andesite intercalated. And then some lenses with the steel-like limestones. And above it, we have the first stratomagmatic breccia, predominantly composed by the sediment class. And then the underneath magma crust, the volcanic dacite in the top of the system, and then the underneath intrusion precursor diorite. The old tonalite are commonly associated with the intense stockwork, when the young tonalite is having less stock work in the middle of the system. The hypervisual dacite cuts everything and it doesn't have any mineralization. And this unit is the root zone of the second fratomagmatic breccia that also contains some of the class of the stock work or porphyry before the dome emplacement in the top of the system. Logging into Jubukit is pretty complicated, especially related to advanced argillic overpin that destroy everything. We cannot see rocks actually into Jubukit. Everything is just white. So we need a technology support for these problems. Using textural recognition from core scan data and also combined with unsupervised machine learning, it helped us clustering some texture, and it's showing us some correlation with lithology. However, maybe this not directly linked to lithology, but in the future, combined with multi-element geochemical data and also hyperspectral core scan data, hopefully we can improve the prediction for lithology. And this is the T-SNE plot. Basically the unsupervised machine learning to visualizing high dimensional data we're using immobile element. It can help us to validate our logging, which is there's mislog or there's some inconsistency between the logging, and also helping us to subdomaining one formation especially. In these cases, we have volcanic dacite and the altonalite that has two clusters. In the macroscopic observation, we cannot separate those lithologies. It just identically same. But in geochemical data, it's showing different population. And also, when we plot this cluster into the three-dimensional software, just like LeapFrog or Micromat, it's showing a different spatial relationship. So that's why we need to separate those cluster as different lithologies.
This is one of the coolest things that we've been doing with our data. And I'll just explain a little bit in some simple terms that that I can easily understand. We basically got all of our geochemical data and we got the software to color code the data according to the different lithologies that you can see on the right-hand side there. And then we let the machine learning do the clustering, and it's clustered these things, clustered our lithos based on the immobile elements. And these things are not spatially located in that round picture on the right. That's just clustering things that are geochemically similar or not so similar. So the interesting thing is that we've amazingly got most of our logging pretty right. And you can see that in this section here where we've got a couple of mistakes where people have called the wrong thing. But generally, the whole lot seems to be pretty nicely matched. But what Habib was saying as well, that this particular this volcanic dacite, we've got two populations of that. So it's suggesting that maybe we didn't quite get the logging right. There's two different subdomains. And as Habib was saying, you can't tell the difference of them if you look at them in hand specimen, but geochemically, they're obviously different. And turns out that when we plot those things up spatially, they're in different locations. And it's the same with the tonalite up at the top up there, where that's showing loosely the inner and the outer parts of the tonalite. Very cool thing to do to validate your logging and also help fine tune your domaining with some relatively simple. You need a high end computer to run it, but this is using the free software. It's Orange, right? Yeah, very cool.
Yeah, basically this helping us to see what previously we cannot see. The alteration into Jubukit is pretty simple. Actually, we have a classic zonation of advanced argillic alteration, overprinting the initial porphyry and some scarification in the distal area. The structural corridor into Jubukit can be divided into pre-porphyry structural corridor and the post-porphyry structural corridor. The pre-porphyry structural corridor are strongly associated with advanced argillic alterations, while the post-porphyry fault doesn't show any relationship with the alteration. However, these post-porphyry structures showing the water pocket zone in each of their segment. So this is going to be helping us in the hydrogeological studies or maybe dewatering strategies in the mining stage. Alteration logging in Tujuh Bukit is supported by core scan hyperspectral data. Basically, every logging almost match with the core scan data. However, there's some concern maybe in the alteration interpretation, especially in the overprinting porphyry. This one is the intense specular hematite after magnetite stock box zones, and the core scan only can detect the monmorillonite or the clay. So this is going to be classified as argillic one. Yeah, indeed, this is argillic, but we need more information that this one is the remnant potassic alteration. Using the hyperspectral data, we also can push our data into its limit rather than only separating to the classic advanced argillic zonation. It still can sub-clustering our alteration into four or two or maybe more cluster. And this and each of this cluster showing different mineralogy composition related to geometallurgy and geotechnical modeling. I guess this is pretty critical because it also affecting our recovery and also upgrading in the metallurgy. And also in the geotechnical, especially with the swelling clay materials, it also need much more concern. That's why this machine learning application is pretty helpful to reveal the ore body understanding.
People often ask what we're actually doing with our core scan data. And of course, helping with the alteration domains is a no-brainer. But some of the other things that we've been using the core scan for is in the mining phases where we've got decline cover holes. And if you can see from the core scan data that you've got a vast amount of montmorillonite or some nasty swelling clays, you know that you're going to have to change your mining schedule to go from type 2 ground, for example, to type 4 ground. So instead of taking one 4-metre cut every day, you're going to take a 1.5-metre cut every 24 hours, and it's going to cost five times as much. So it can really help with your budgeting and your scheduling. And also from a drilling perspective, if you've drilled a big hole like a 400 or 500 or 900 meter hole, and turns out that you've got the casing stuck and the HQ is also stuck, you can work out where you should be making your cuts based on the core scan data. It can really help to say, well, we can see all those really sticky clays down there. Let's make sure we come above that before we make our first cut with the rod cutters. But the true power for us, where the core scan data is going to come into play, is when the mill rats are later on trying to work out how to process and get the metal out of the rock and get it to froth up properly in the processing plant. They're going to, for those guys to know where the montmorillonite is and where the illite is, and where all those other sticky bits or the frothy bits or the slushy bits. That's going to be a massive help for those guys in the processing component of the geometallurgical world.
So for the machine learning, the main thing is clean your data and start let them tell the story. And this is the final part from geology, the Tujuh Bukit metal zoning. As we can see that the copper, gold, and moly are always localized in the outer of the post-porphyry lithologies. As well as in the box plot, we can see that the host of the base mineralization are always in the porphyry and the post-porphyry lithologies. In the cross-section, we can see that there is a clear rheological boundary in the middle of the system. So because these lithologies are cutting the initial porphyry mineralization.
So this is an important observation. Previously, there was a perception that the metal distribution was controlled by the alteration and not controlled by the lithologies. So because we've drilled a hole, stacked more holes, we can clearly show, as Havid is showing right here, that the metal is mostly distributed, or it is distributed exactly where you'd expect it to see in a porphyry. So it's in the outer bits of those intrusives, and it's in the proximal rocks, or the rocks that are proximal to those intrusives. It's not being blown around by the alteration, which was a previous conception.
And in the alteration modeling, we can see that there is no significant correlation mineralization. And also in the boss block, we don't see any correlation between those alteration and mineralization. This is pretty common because this alteration is just an overprint after the initial porphyry alteration or mineralization.
So the high sulfidation alteration hasn't moved the metal of the porphyry around very much. Might have changed its state, but it's pretty much where you'd expect to see it in a porphyry context.
In the stock block modeling, we divided our model into high stock block and low stock block zones. And this is pretty interesting because the copper, gold, and moly are always localized in the outer of the intense stock block rather than in the intense stock block. It's pretty strange because in Batu Hijau or Grasberg, the classic porphyry showing a direct link to the intensity of the stock block. Possibly this is answer our remobilization postulate because in the intense stock block, it doesn't show any mineralization. Even in the medium stock block, doesn't have any mineralization. Slightly to the outer of the porphyry without any stock block, it's showing the best gold, copper, and moly mineralization. Although the advanced argillic alteration doesn't bring any copper mineralization, understanding the alteration is pretty important, especially with the evidence of mineral transformation from the mineral liberation analysis in the argillic domain, which is less overprinted. We can see that the mineralization is still the initial porphyry mineralization with the chalcopyrite and bornite mineralization. While in the advanced argillic alteration, some of them already changes to energite and coplite, or even totally changes to the coplite. So basically, the alteration doesn't bring any mineralization, but changes our mineralization, and it affecting the geotechnical studies and also geometallurgical study. Okay. From this slide, I will hand over it to Pak Rob. Maybe please, Pak Rob.
Thank you, Pak. I guess what this shows is some of the recent results we've had and what our forward program is. This year, we're looking at drilling about 70 kilometres alone this year. So we're banging away with lots of holes. As you'll have seen recently, we've had some pretty good hits. And I'm trying to work out how to go to the next floor. That one. This was coming from our web page. It shows that we've had some absolute cracker of a hit over the last 2 years. We're up there with the best of them. And interestingly, a lot of these hits are from our neighbours just up the road or along the island arc. So that's pretty cool. Here's a quick look at some hits. This one is an absolute cracker. I wonder if I could zoom in on that. Yes, I can. And you can see this one's something like nearly 600 metres at 0.9 and 1 gram per tonne gold, including 500 metres at 1 and 1.2. What a fantastic hit. And there's another nice one down here, I think. This one is, 917 metres at 0.7 and 0.8. Yahoo. Oh, that's another good one. Yeah, this one also shows, this shows our previously interpreted areas of the plus 0.5. And this hole has just made that 0.5 grow all that way. It's another absolute cracker of a hit. 500 metres at 0.6 and 0.8. One thing that keeps it all together here is our workflow. We won't go through this too much, but you can see we have this workflow that we stick by. We've got this posted all around the place. We've also got an absolutely spectacular core shed. When the core sort of gets delivered here and then it sort of finds its way through here, goes through the core scan, core photography, comes down through this logging system. These are little portholes and it goes through the wall here into the core cutting area. And then get sampled, and then we've got our own on-site prep facility. So this is where these guys are doing they weigh it wet and they weigh it dry and they crush it and everything like that. And I've got a little video that I'm potentially going to show how that works in action. And I think that's about where I am going to press this button here. Whoops, wait on. How do we get that bar? Yeah, that's it. Yes, click that one. Okay, fingers crossed. Hopefully you can see this. That's the front of the core shed. We've got a few dragon fruit tree there, which are fruiting heavily almost all year round. That's a view of some old core getting ready to be stacked away down in the core farm. And this is inside the core shed. We've got a quarter of a million bucks worth of roller racks there. And there's the office down at the far end. This is a view from inside the office, and you can see what the people are doing outside, which is kind of good in a fishbowl context. We keep people focused on the geology, and we refer to these sections about where all the current drill holes are at any given moment. These are the same slides we've looked at. There's the workflow and the core shed to keep people doing the same thing every day, make sure no one gets distracted. We stick with the plan. And there's an old guy. There's someone talking. There's a few geologists. Here's how the core turns up. Core turns up there. The drillers drop it off. We drop that thing down there to reduce the manual handling. Some of these guys in the volunteer outfits just roll that core over there, and then they move a bit more quickly. And these core trays get those lids off, recycle those lids. We only use the lids to move the core back and forth. And they hose it down out there, making sure they don't hose away too much at the start. We'll fast forward a little bit here. Here comes this thing. The idea is to reduce manual handling. So these guys are using the tools as best that they can. They get it in the right spot there, mate. That's it. And these guys roll that in there. Next thing that happens is it gets equi-tipped and probed, and core photography. And this is a fantastic core photography system. Dun-dun-dun. Here we are, making sure all the bits are lined up properly, all done with a computer, all sorts of care taken there. So the guys just knocked this video up yesterday, which I think is a pretty good job. After those things happen, we put the core in the oven, and we cook it at about 60 degrees to make sure we don't boil off any mercury, because we do like to keep a check on that kind of stuff. There we are, put another one in there, poke that in there, close the door, take it easy, fellas. Oops, rushing. No, that's fast forward, that's not rushing. Into the core scan. Everyone loves it. It's great. It's air conditioned. This guy's rocking out to some heavy metal, but luckily you can't hear it. He's looking at the spectra and making sure that the QAQC is done properly. There's some beautiful blue covalite in that piece of core that's about to go into the core scan thingy. And core scan can detect covalite. It's one of the few sulfides that it can look at. Every good core shed has an old bloke that hangs around, and sometimes he has a cat with him. This lady's using that IQ logger. That thing measures the angles of the structures. This guy's doing the good old-fashioned mag sus. And this guy's going to crack the core with the PLT thing. We do these PLTs every 5 metres, so the geotechs love it. There's a geotech trying to make as much noise as he can. Everyone hates it when they whack that core, but geotechs seem to love doing that. And after the core's been logged, it goes through this porthole, and here's what you can see in there, core saws. These guys are really cranking the core through. We're doing something like 100 metres a day with those core saws. After the core is cut, it comes back outside here. These guys all carefully bag it up. You can see this guy's getting ready. Put the core in that thing. I'll just fast forward that a little bit. After it goes through there, we've got our own on-site prep facility. These two ladies are doing a inspection, and you can see the ovens are over there. She's making sure it's cooking at 60. There's the work plan, the workflow on the wall, so everyone does the same thing every time, even the guys in this room. We weigh the core wet, then we dry it, and we weigh it dry, and we put it through the terminator crusher. That guy's cleaning the terminator crusher there. He's gone pretty well. And then over here is the Boyd crusher with a rotary splitter. As we all know, the rotary splitters on the board is one of the best splitters on the market. These guys are putting the powder into the bags. No one's watching TikTok videos. Everyone's doing their jobs. I think, is that it? Is that the end of our presentation? Oh, yeah, we've got one more. How do we do that? It looks like, there we are. This is the second last slide. That's me on the left-hand side there, standing next to that some of that greeny-looking rock on the island of Bulimera. And sometimes we have field excursions out there, and you can see there's some of the team going down there. The reason I'm not wearing a yellow shirt is I was on my way out that day about to fly home. Otherwise, I would have been wearing a yellow shirt as well. And that's the photo from where I drink a coffee at the end of the day on the beach while I watch the sunset and sometimes play some guitar. And you can see the tides up there. You can't look across the pool mirror on that particular time. Okay, that's it. Thank you.
That was awesome. Thank you so much for sharing all that with us.